hard drive is the most significant improvement you can make to your computer. The more you do with your computer, the more memory you'll need. The more memory you have, the more you can do. An accelerator will speed up everything but disk access. It's a dramatic difference. TrueType is a new font technology developed for the Macintosh. All work and no play makes Joe a dull boy, but Signature is fun. It's the world's first System 6 utility package. It's a must-have for any serious System 6 user.
appropriate.
Salvation Supreme, it's everything you need for your hard drive, all in one box. System 6 is one of the most exciting developments in 2GS history. It gives your computer a real boost in features and performance. The Quality Computer's System 6 Bonus Pack is an economical way to upgrade to System 6 and add a lot of other fun extras to your system. But you already knew that because you bought one. System 6 now features support for Apple's low-cost, high-resolution printer, the StyleWriter. It can also access Macintosh, Apple DOS 3.3, and Apple Pascal disks directly without the need for a translation program. The System 6 Finder has also been completely redesigned. It's now faster, friendlier, and more powerful than ever, with advanced features like tunneling and Finder extensions. There's a collection of all new desk accessories, including a calculator and file finder. Even the control panel has been revamped. System 6 also has new music and media tools, including a program that turns the 2GS into a digital synthesizer and sequencer, plus improved system support for video disc and CD-ROM. There's a set of special aids, including video keyboard, close view, and easy access, to make it easier for physically handicapped users to use the 2GS. Plus, there are a lot of new tools that will allow new software to do even more amazing things. For example, there's a driver for SCSI scanners. You can't use it directly, but it makes it possible to write a program that talks to an Apple flatbed scanner. Our System 6 Bonus Pack adds even more great features to System 6. The Bonus Pack includes useful desk accessories like a scientific calculator, memory and performance monitors, a mini finder for working with disks inside any program, a music player, and a scrapbook, even a program launcher. There are more than 100 clip art images perfect for desktop publishing or hypermedia applications. We included 50 digitized sounds. Use them as system beeps or in HyperCard GS. There's even a conversion program to allow you to use the sounds in HyperStudio and other programs. To make your documents even more attention-getting, we also included more than 30 attractive fonts for all occasions. And let's not forget the icons. We've thrown in icons for popular applications and their documents so you can identify all your files at a glance. As if that weren't enough, we also included several other utilities, including Flash Boot, ZZ Copy, and font and icon editors. To use System 6, you need at least 1.25 megabytes of RAM and a 3.5-inch disk drive. With only the minimum configuration, there are limits to what you can do. You won't be able to use the sound control panel to change the system's beep. You also won't be able to read Macintosh disks or run SynthLab. So we suggest 3 or 4 megabytes of memory and a hard drive. That will give you the power you need to take full advantage of System 6's new features. Frankly, if you're using a 1.25 megabyte system with only 3.5-inch drives, you won't notice a lot of difference between System 5 and System 6. But the more memory and disk space you have, the more new features you'll be able to use. We hope you enjoy System 6 and the System 6 Bonus Pack. Next, I'll show you how to back up your disks and prepare to install them on the hard drive. Before beginning installation, be sure to back up your system disks and Bonus Pack disks.
The Bonus Pack Utilities disk contains a program called ZZ Copy, which will make this process very simple. Or you can use any kind that's familiar, Copy 2 Plus, Fast Copy, or the Finder itself. Assuming you decide to use ZZ Copy, you'll first insert the utilities disk into the 3.5-inch drive. Now, hold down the Option key while turning on the computer. When this screen appears, press 1 to enter the control panel. Now use the up or down arrow keys to highlight slots and press return. Use the up or down arrow keys to highlight startup. Make a mental note of its current settings and then use the left and right arrow keys to change it to 5. Finally, press return, then escape, then return again to exit the control panel. Your computer will continue starting up and the utilities disk will boot. ZZ Copy will take a few seconds to load. Then the utilities disk will eject and the ZZ Copy screen will appear. When you see the message Insert Source, put one of your original System 6 disks into your drive. ZZ Copy will read the disk into memory. In a little while, the original disk will be ejected. When you see the message Insert Target, put in a blank or reusable disk. If you have two 3.5-inch drives, put the disk into the second drive. Be sure the disk is blank, or at least that you can afford to lose what's on it before you put it in. ZZ Copy will copy the information onto your blank disk. In a moment, your new disk will be ejected. Be sure to label it clearly. ZZ Copy displays Insert Source again. That's your cue to put in the next original System 6 disk and start the copy process again. Keep doing this until you've copied all of the System 6 and Bonus Pack disks. Then, take the originals and put them in a safe place and use the copies. Now, turn off the computer. If you would like both System 5 and System 6 on your hard drive, you may install Switch Hitter now. We won't cover that procedure in this video, but you may consult the Switch Hitter documentation for further details. If you have an external SCSI-compatible hard drive, you're ready to begin installation. Place your backup copy of the install disk in your 3.5-inch drive. Turn on the computer and skip ahead to the next section of this video. If, on the other hand, you have an Applied Engineering Vulkan hard drive, you'll need to install the Vulkan driver on your system disk before beginning installation. First, boot your backup copy of the system disk. In a moment, the Finder will appear. Now, double-click the system disk icon to open it. Find the system folder and double-click it while holding down the Option key. The system disk window should close, but the system window should remain open. Find the drivers folder, but don't double-click it. The drivers folder is where we'll put the Vulkan driver. Now, put in the disk that came with your Vulkan. If you have only one 3.5-inch drive, you'll have to eject the system disk first. If you have two drives, just put the Vulkan disk in the second one. Double-click the Vulkan disk. Hold down the Option key and double-click the System folder to open that folder and close the Vulkan window at the same time. Find the Drivers folder and again, hold down the Option key while you double-click it. You should end up with two windows open, System from the System disk and Drivers from the Vulkan disk. Arrange the windows so that they don't overlap too much, and so that you can see the drivers folder in the system window. Now, find the Vulkan driver in the drivers window. Use the mouse to drag this icon on top of the drivers folder in the system window. When the drivers folder icon turns black, release the mouse button. If you have only a single 3.5-inch disk drive, you'll need to switch disks a couple of times during the copy process. The Finder will tell you when to switch disks. Just eject the disk that's in the drive and insert the disk that the Finder asks you for. The Finder will automatically notice the new disk. You don't have to press return. After you've copied the Vulkan driver onto the system disk, put the system disk back in the drive if necessary and restart the computer. When the Finder reappears, your Vulkan icons should appear on the screen. Eject the system disk now and insert the install disk. Double-click the install disk icon. Then, find the installer icon and double-click that. If you have only one 3.5-inch disk drive, you'll be in for some more disk swapping. The computer will ask for the disk that it needs by name. Just eject the disk that's currently in the drive and insert the correct disk. Eventually, the installer screen should appear. Now you're ready to go on to the next segment and install System 6. If you followed the instructions in the previous section, you're ready to begin installation of System 6. You should be using the backup copies of your System 6 disks, and if you have a Vulkan hard drive, you should have already installed the Vulkan driver on your system disk. After starting the install disk, you should see this screen, the installer's easy update screen on your monitor. We'll first show you how to install the basic System 6 software on your hard drive. We suggest that you install just that first, and then test to see if the installation was successful before you install any additional features. So, let's install System 6. First, make sure the installer is set to update your hard drive startup partition by looking here on the screen. Our first hard drive partition is called Q1, and that's the disk the installer is ready to update. If the installer is displaying a different disk's name, click the Change Disk button here to make the installer look at the next disk or hard drive partition in your system. Now we're ready to go. Click the Easy Update button to begin installation. The installer will tell you what disks to put in. Just insert the requested disk, ejecting any other disk that's in the way. Again, you won't have to press return. The installer will automatically notice the new disk. Here, the installer is just about finished with the installation. Just press return when the installation is finished. Next, you'll want to reset the startup slot so that the computer will start up from the hard drive. Enter the control panel by holding down the Control and Apple keys while you press and release the Escape key. Select Control Panel from this menu and press Return. Then, select Slots and press Return. Finally, move the highlighter to the startup item and change the startup slot back to what it was before you started the installation. In our case, it was Scan, so we use the left and right arrow keys to change the value to Scan. Now, press Return, then Escape, then Return. Then quit the control panel. You should come back to the installer screen. Finally, press and hold the Control and Open Apple keys, and then press and release the Reset key. In a few seconds, you'll see the System 6 thermometer screen appear. You'll notice one difference right away. The thermometer screen says System 6 right on it. If you successfully reached the Finder screen, the installation was a success. You might want to take some time out to explore a little. Play with System 6. Pause the tape if you like. We'll wait. Now that you've verified that you've installed System 6 properly, we're ready to move on. There are some other features in System 6 that you'll probably want to install. Make sure the install disk is still in the drive and double-click the install disk icon. Now, find the installer icon in that window and double-click it. In a moment, the now familiar installer screen will appear. This time, click the Customize button. This leads to the Customized Installation screen. The Customized Installation screen lists all the System 6 updates in this list here. You'll select the updates you want to install from this list. To select your first update, just click it. For example, you'll want to install the Archiver application, so we'll just click that. Now, to select additional updates to be at the same time, hold down the Apple key while you click the other updates. The Apple key tells the installer to install that update in addition to any others you have selected. If you have at least 2 megabytes of RAM, we suggest the following updates: Archiver, SynthLab, and Teach Applications, the Sound Control Panel, and Find File and Calculator Desk Accessories. All the File System Translators, or FSTs, and all fonts. Also, be sure to go through the Drivers section and select drivers for any extra devices attached to your system. For example, a CD-ROM driver or a scanner. Remember, keep holding down the Apple key as you select these updates. By the way, drivers for SCSI hard disks and standard 3.5 and 5.25 inch drives and most printers have already been installed. You won't need to install these drivers, although you won't hurt anything if you do. Before actually beginning installation, make sure the disk name here is the disk you booted from. It probably won't be. In this case, we want to install to Q1, so we click the disk button repeatedly until Q1 appears. Finally, click the Install button, and installation will begin. As before, the installer will ask for the disks it needs. Just insert the disks as they're needed. You don't have to press return. There's a more detailed list of the updates you can install in Chapter 2 of the System 6 book under the heading of Installing Additional Features. When installation is complete, press return. You'll notice that there's a message here at the bottom of the screen that says you can no longer use desk accessories. Don't panic. The message doesn't mean that you have permanently lost your desk accessories. All you have to do is restart, and your desk accessories will be available again. So click quit, and then restart. Always install the system software with the Apple installer. The installer will make sure that the files you need are present and up to date. If you just copy the files with the Finder, it's easy to miss something, and that may cause strange problems later. Now we're ready to install the System 6 bonus pack. Insert the bonus stuff disk and double-click it. Then find the icon called GSHK and double-click it. The GSHK application is GSShrinkIt, a data compression utility. We used this program to compress the bonus pack so that we could include a maximum amount of great stuff. Let's install the desk accessories that come with the bonus pack first. First, move the pointer to the File menu and pull it down by pressing and holding the mouse button. Drag the pointer down to the Open menu item and release the mouse button. This is a standard File Open dialog. Find DeskAxSHK in this list and double-click it to open it. This window displays a list of all the files in the archive. We want to install all of the bonus desk accessories. The easiest way to do that is to pull down the Edit menu and choose Select All. Now, click the Extract button. This dialog window is asking you where you want to put the desk accessories. Click the Volumes button, then double-click your hard drive startup partition from the list. In this case, it's Q1. Now, find and double-click the System folder. Then, since we're installing desk accessories, we find and double-click the Desk Axe folder. Finally, click the Extract button to begin installing the desk accessories. When that's finished, click the Close box in the upper left corner of the window to close it. Installing the rest of the bonus pack is done in much the same way. Here's how to do it. Let's install the bonus sounds next. In order to install the bonus sounds, you must have already installed the sound control panel. If you are following our recommendations, you've done that. There are two disks of sounds. Choose Open from the File menu. Then, insert the Bonus Sounds 1 disk. Shrink It will automatically switch to that disk. Double-click the Sounds 1 SHK file. Choose Select All from the Edit menu. Then, click the Extract button. Click the Volumes button, then double-click your hard drive startup partition. Ours is Q1. Then double-click the System folder, then double-click the Sounds folder. Finally, click Extract. Follow the same procedures to install the second disk of sounds. We won't repeat the instructions here. There are also two disks of bonus fonts. Again, start by choosing Open from the GS Shrinkit file menu. Insert the Bonus Fonts 1 disk and open the Fonts 1 SHK file. Choose Select All from the Edit menu, then click Extract. Click Volumes, then open your hard drive startup partition, Q1 in our case, and then open the System folder and the Fonts folder. Finally, click Extract. Again, follow the same procedure for the second disk of fonts. Let's install the Finder extensions next. This procedure should be starting to seem familiar. Choose Open again, then insert the Bonus Stuff disk. Open Finder Ext SHK. Choose Select All, then click Extract. Click Volumes, then double-click Q1. Or your hard drive's name. Then double-click System, then double-click System Setup. Finally, click Extract. The icons are also on the Bonus Stuff disk. Select Open, then double-click Icons SHK. You can skip Select All because there's only one file and it's already selected. Just click Extract. Once again, click Volumes, then open Q1 or your hard drive's name. But instead of double-clicking System, open Icons. Then click Extract. Finally, let's unpack the clip art. Open Clip Art SHK. And choose Select All. Then click Extract. Click Volumes. Then double-click on your hard drive's name, Q1 on our system. Finally, click Extract. GS Shrinkit is a very useful general-purpose utility program. You can use it to increase hard drive space by compressing files that you don't use very much. There's a detailed manual for Shrinkit on the Bonus Stuff disk. When you're done installing the bonus pack, quit GS Shrink It. In a moment, the Finder will appear. Choose Shutdown from the Special menu. Then click Restart, then click OK. When the Finder reappears, all of the bonus pack software will be available for you to use. In the next segment, we'll show you some basics of using the Apple IIgs Desktop and Finder. Stay tuned. In this segment, we'll teach you the basics of operating IIgs desktop programs, including the Finder. If you're already an experienced IIgs user, you can probably skip this segment. The Apple IIgs features what is called a graphical user interface. That sounds complicated and technical, but really it makes the computer much easier to use. From your point of view, it means that you can use the mouse to control programs. These programs communicate with you using pictures instead of text. The IIgs user interface is called the Apple Desktop. It's the same user interface made popular by the Macintosh, and it has several advantages. First, the Apple Desktop is intuitive. Many of the things you see on the screen behave just like their real-world equivalents. For example, you probably already know how to use a calculator in real life, which means you already know how to use the calculator desk accessory included with System 6. The Apple Desktop is also direct. You operate directly on objects on the screen by clicking them and dragging them around. Just like in real life, you first select the object you want to work with, then tell the computer what to do. Finally, the Apple Desktop is consistent. When you use an Apple Desktop program, you can safely assume certain things about the way the program operates, even if you've never used it before. As you can imagine, this makes learning to use new programs considerably simpler. The Apple IIgs can also run older 2E and 2C programs. The features of the desktop, however, are only accessible when you're running IIgs-specific applications. Let's look at a simple desktop program. This is the Finder. It's the first program you see when you start up System 6. You'll probably use it frequently, so it's a good place to start. As you can see, moving the mouse around on your real-world desktop moves a pointer around on the screen. The pointer is a fundamental and important part of all Apple desktop programs. You'll use it to point and select things, and the pointer itself will sometimes change appearance to give you visual feedback about what you're doing. These objects here on the right-hand side of the screen are icons. Icons are used to represent disks, programs, and documents. These represent our hard drive partitions. And this is a 3.5-inch disk. This is a window. In the Finder, windows are used to display the contents of disks and folders. In most other programs, windows display documents that you're working on. Windows can be moved, resized, and scrolled. Finally, take note of the menu bar at the top of the screen. The titles on the menu bar, File, Edit, Windows, and so on, describe the kinds of things you can do in a program. You can pull down on the menus to select an option or just to browse through a program's features. Be sure to check out chapters 3 and 4 of the System 6 book for more on using the Apple desktop and the mouse. Let's take a closer look at the menu bar. First, notice that some of the menu titles, Windows and View, are dimmed. Both of these menus work on Windows, and we don't have any windows open on this screen, so these menus simply don't apply. We can still pull them down to see what's there, but all the items in the menus are dimmed also. Let's take a look at the disk menu. This menu also has a dimmed item. Our currently selected disk is a hard drive. You can't eject a hard drive, so the Finder dims the eject option. Since we now have a window open, we can use the View menu. Notice that the Buy Icon item has a check mark next to it, because the Finder is displaying the files in the window as icons. If you choose by name, you'll get an alphabetical listing. The check mark in the View menu has moved to the By Name item. This check mark, then, tells you the current setting of the View menu. Through the magic of video, we are now in the Teach application, a mini word processor included with System 6. The font menu in this program also has a check mark to tell you what font you're using. The size menu has a check mark to tell you what type size you're using. The style menu can have multiple check marks. For example, if your text is bold-faced or underlined, those styles will have check marks next to them. Let's go back to the Finder. The erase option on the disk menu has three periods after it. That tells you that the Finder will need more information before it can carry out your instructions. In this case, a dialog appears to let us fill in the new name of a disk and choose its format. We'll cover dialogs in a moment. The color menu is a good example of a custom menu. Instead of having a list of color names, you get a swatch of each color. This menu works just like the other menus, except you can also move the mouse sideways. Some of the menu items have key equivalents. For example, you can choose the Select All option by holding down the Apple key and pressing A. Most programs have certain standardized menus, making it even easier to learn new applications. All desktop programs have the Apple menu, which usually contains a help function or the program's About This Program information. Your desk accessories are also displayed in this menu. Desk accessories are small programs like the calculator, which can be used inside any other program. The File menu contains options for creating, opening, closing, and printing documents. The Edit menu allows you to make changes to your document, including the Cut, Copy, Paste, and Undo options. Often, Find and other related functions are located here as well. Most of the other menus are specific to individual programs. For example, in word processors like Teach, you'll have a Font, Style, and Size menus. Now let's take a look at two more important elements of the Apple desktop: the dialog window and its cousin, the alert window. This is an alert window, or just an alert. A desktop program uses an alert window to tell you something you need to know and give you a chance to respond. Here's the message: the item Teach already exists. Replace this item. These buttons are your means of responding to the computer's message. Click the Cancel button to stop the copy operation, or click Replace to go ahead and replace the existing file with the one you're moving. Often, you'll see an icon in the upper left-hand corner of the alert. This is a caution icon. It tells us that we might have accidentally done something that could cause us to lose some data. In this case, if we choose Replace, the computer will erase the existing file called Teach and replace it with a new one. The old file will be gone. This is a stop icon. It tells us that the computer can't complete the operation we asked it to perform. In this case, we just acknowledge that we've read the message by clicking the Cancel button. This is a note icon. This alert tells us that we can now turn off the computer because we have selected the shutdown option. We don't have to take any action, and there's not really anything wrong. The computer is just using the note alert to keep us informed. Here are some common buttons you'll see in alerts. An OK button acknowledges an alert and tells the computer to continue. It tells the computer, "I've read your message." A Continue button has many of the same connotations as OK, but is usually used in situations where you can choose to continue or cancel an operation. A Cancel button tells the computer to stop what it's doing and give you control of the machine. If there's an operation in progress, cancel, the computer undoes the operation, as if you've never started it. A Stop button also stops the operation in progress, but doesn't undo the operation in progress. With some long, complicated operations, there's no way for the computer to back out gracefully. When you click a Stop button, an operation may be left partially completed. By the way, you can also use the keyboard to respond to alerts. Pressing Return is the same as clicking the button with the double outline, and pressing Escape is usually the same as clicking the Cancel button, if there is one. If there are other buttons, you can respond to them just by typing the first letter of their name. This is a dialog window, or just a dialog. This one happens to be the one the Finder gives you when you tell it to initialize a disk. Dialogs appear whenever the computer needs additional information before it can carry out your request. Any menu item that ends with three periods will lead to a dialog. You'll recognize the yellow caution icon here, which reminds you that you should be careful because you might lose data if you initialize the wrong disk. There's also a warning message. And these buttons here at the bottom of the dialog tell the computer whether to go ahead and initialize the disk or to cancel the operation without initializing the disk. This here is called a line edit field because it lets you enter and edit a line of text. In this case, you fill in the name you want to give to your new disk. These are called list fields because they contain lists of items you can choose. In this case, you choose the format you want to give your disk from the left list and the size and interleave from the right list. If there were more items in this list, you'd be able to scroll the list using the arrows. You can fill in the fields in a dialog in any order you like. Once you've filled in the necessary information, click the appropriate button at the bottom of the dialog to begin the operation. This is the Finder's Preferences dialog. Most programs have a Preferences dialog, which allows you to customize the program to your needs. These are checkboxes. Each time you click a checkbox, it toggles between on and off. If it's on, clicking turns it off. If it's off, clicking turns it back on. You don't have to click the checkbox itself. Hitting the text beside the checkbox is usually enough. This is the Finder's shutdown dialog. It contains some radio buttons. They're called radio buttons because they look and act sort of like the buttons on a car radio for selecting stations. As you can see, clicking one of the buttons turns off any others that might be on. This is the Finder's help window. It's not exactly a dialog, but it does contain one other important item you'll often find in dialogs, a pop-up menu. A pop-up menu is a lot like a pull-down menu. Just click it and hold down the mouse button. Then select an option from the menu. When the menu isn't popped up, its current setting is displayed. This downward pointing arrow is a clue that this control is a pop-up menu. Not all pop-up menus have an arrow, though. Speaking of windows, let's take a closer look at them now. When you open a disk or folder in the Finder, its contents appear in a window. Other programs also use windows to show you the contents of a document, for example, a letter or a report. We've already encountered some simple windows, alerts and dialogs. These kinds of windows are called modal windows because you can't do anything else until you've dealt with them. This window is a little more flexible. You'll see windows like this in almost every 2GS program. For example, the window can be moved around and placed anywhere on the screen. Just position the pointer at the top of the window in its title bar. Now click and hold the button down as you move the mouse around. An outline of the window will move with the pointer. When you release the pointer, the window will appear at the new location. This is called dragging a window. You can also make the window larger or smaller by dragging its resize box. To explode the window to its largest possible size, click the zoom box. A second click of the zoom box collapses the window to its original size. You can scroll the window to see its entire contents. Click one of the scroll arrows to reveal more of the window's contents in that direction. This white box, called the elevator, or sometimes a thumb, moves to reflect how far you scroll in either direction. You can also click the gray areas around the elevator to page through a window full of information at a time, or drag the elevator itself to a new location. And finally, you can make the window disappear by clicking its close box here. You can, of course, have more than one window open at a time. Let's open a couple of windows. When you have more than one window open, you'll notice that only one has stripes in its title bar. That window is the active window. You select the active window by simply clicking anywhere in the window. That window will get the stripes and will move in front of the other windows. Think of the windows on the screen as a pile of papers on your desk. Before you can work with a window, you must first bring it to the top of the pile. Windows are completely independent of each other. They can be positioned, sized, and manipulated separately. Different programs support different numbers of open windows. The Finder can handle about a dozen or so. Some applications, like the Finder, have a Windows menu, which allows you to bring any open window to the front without having to hunt through the whole pile. That's it for our brief tour of the Apple desktop. With this information, you're halfway to using any 2GS program, even if you've never used it before. See chapters 3, 4, and 5 of the System 6 book for much more information. Next, we'll show you more about the Finder itself. The Finder is probably the most frequently used part of System 6. It's also the part we most frequently get questions about. So we're going to show you how to do a few everyday tasks with the Finder. Along the right side of your Finder screen are your disk icons. You'll see one icon for each disk or disk drive attached to your system. You'll also see a trash icon, which we'll discuss shortly. We've already seen how to open a disk icon by double-clicking it. When you open a disk, a window appears to display the disk's contents. We showed you how to work with Windows in the last segment. When you open a window in the Finder displays the contents of the disk as icons. Let's take a look at some of them. This is a folder icon, the system folder to be exact. If you double-click a folder icon, another window will open. Folders are organizational tools. You use them to keep related groups of files under one name, in this case, System. If folders didn't exist, all of the contents of your disk would appear in one cluttered window. The System folder keeps all the files that make up System 6 organized. Inside the System folder are several files, such as Start.gsos and ErrorMessage, and several other folders, such as Drivers, CDEVs, Desk Accessories, and Fonts. System 6 expects to find typefaces or fonts in the Fonts folder. If you wanted to put more fonts on your hard drive, you would put them in the Fonts folder. We did exactly that when we installed the bonus fonts. The System folder is a special folder because System 6 itself is stored there. However, you can and should create your own folders to organize your own programs and files. Folders can't exist by themselves. Every folder must be inside a disk or another folder. For example, here's the Q1 window again. It represents the contents of the hard drive called Q1. Inside this disk is the System folder. And inside the System folder is the Fonts folder. We could make another folder named Fonts in the Q1 window, but it would be a totally different folder from the one in the System window. To make a new folder, first open the window where you want the folder to appear. We'll put our new folder in our hard drive's main window, the Q1 window, so it'll be easy to get to. Now select New Folder from the File menu. A new folder called Untitled will appear in the front window. You might have to scroll the window to find the new folder. You probably don't want to call it Untitled. Just type the new name, we'll call it Quality, and press Return. The new folder is ready for use. Double-click it and you can see what's inside it. Nothing yet. So let's put something inside it. We'll do that by copying a program from a floppy disk. Let's open that up now. Here's GSHK, a compression utility. We'll put that on our hard drive in the new folder. First, make sure you can see the Q1 window and the quality folder in it. Then, just drag the file on top of the quality folder. When the folder turns black, release the mouse button. Now, if we open the quality folder, we'll see the GSHK icon in it. We could have achieved the same results by opening the quality window and dragging the GSHK icon directly into it. Remember, the quality folder icon and the quality window both represent the same folder. To delete a file, just drag it to the trash icon. Release the mouse button when the trash can turns black. Putting a file in the trash doesn't delete it right away. The Finder gives you a chance to change your mind.
Just open the trash like any other icon. Click the file you don't want to delete and choose Put Away from the File menu. As you can see, the icon moves back to its original folder. If you decide you do want to delete the file, choose Empty Trash from the Special menu. Now it's gone permanently.
Putting a folder in the trash throws all of its contents into the trash.
The hypersound icon is an application icon. It's a diamond shape resembling a hand writing on a sheet of paper. When you double-click an application icon, the Finder launches the program. You leave the Finder and begin using the other program.
Some applications have custom icons. This is the icon for Teach, a program that comes with System 6. But notice that it still looks like a diamond.
This is a document icon. Most document icons look like a sheet of paper with a folded down corner. This happens to be a Teach document, but most documents have the same basic shape. When you double-click a document icon, the Finder will launch the application that created it and tell it to open the document, if the Finder knows which application created it. In this case, the Finder knows that the Teach application created this document, so it launches Teach, and Teach opens the document.
Sometimes the Finder won't know which application created a document. In that case, you'll see an alert that tells you that the application can't be found. That's it for basic Finder features. There's quite a bit more to the Finder, though, and you can read more in Chapter 6 of the System 6 book. Before we go, though, we'd like to show you just a few new Finder features that make life much easier.
First, let's close all the open windows. The 2GS screen gets cluttered pretty quickly if you have more than three or four windows open. Now, we could close all the windows one at a time by clicking their close boxes, but there's an easier way. Just hold down the Option key while you click the close box of the frontmost window, and the Finder will close them all. Now we'll show you a way to avoid cluttering your screen with extraneous windows. First, we'll open the Q1 icon again. Now, we'll hold down the Option key while we open the System folder. The Finder opens the System folder for us and automatically closes the Q1 icon for us.
The Option key tells the Finder that we don't need the Q1 window anymore. This new feature is called tunneling.
Now, let's tunnel into the CDevs folder. This folder contains the control panel devices you can see in the 2GS control panel. Hold down Option while you open the CDevs folder. If we want to find out exactly where we are, we can just hold down the Apple key while we click on the window's name. This pop-up menu tells us exactly where we are on the hard drive. We're in the CDevs folder, which is in the System folder, which is on the hard drive called Q1. What's more, we can easily backtrack to any window in this menu. Just point to it and release the mouse button, and the window opens right up. If we hold down both the Apple and Option keys when we select another window, the Finder opens that window and closes the one we started with. That's called reverse tunneling.
These new features make it much easier to navigate through the Finder without filling the whole screen with windows. We hope you found this video interesting and informative, and that it makes using System 6 easier. Be sure to read your System 6 book closely for more information on using all aspects of System 6. For Quality Computers, I'm Walker Archer. Thanks for watching.